Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. It's Open Line First Friday. It's your opportunity to pose whatever question you have about the journey of faith, following Jesus Christ, about the Catholic Church, about the struggles of the journey towards the Catholic Church. I have with us a guest this evening who was with us once before, Dr. Ed Echeverria, who's a professor and chairman of philosophy at Concepcion Seminary College in Northwest Missouri. He was with us before and talked, along with his journey of faith, he also talked about the importance of believing what is true and the truth of our faith. And I'm sure we'll get into some of those issues tonight. But this is Open Line First Friday, so it's your opportunity to ask whatever question you make him uncomfortable. Come up with some biggies. That's what he's here. Ready? Are you ready for whatever?
I'm ready.
Okay, good. We'll start by asking some other questions to prime the pump. But you can start calling now and giving us emails now, and as soon as we get them, we'll start answering them. It's 1-800-221-9460 or journeyhome@ewtn.com. Dr. Echeverria, welcome back to the program.
Good to be here, Marcus.
It wasn't that long ago that we
No, it was the end of March.
That's right. And I wanted to have you back because the regular program goes so quickly.
Right.
That I knew from the number of phone calls and emails that we had then that it would be great to have you back. You teach philosophy, and I think particularly with John Paul releasing his recent encyclical on the relationship between faith and reason, which we'll talk about in a moment, it's good to have someone that can bring philosophy down to our level.
I'll do my best.
All right. Well, let's begin first as a reminder to the audience. Summarize a bit of your journey into the faith.
Well, I just briefly recap. I was born in Mexico, into a Catholic family. My parents immigrated to the United States when I was about 2 years old. Went to Catholic schools in New York City. Grew up in the Bronx, but I didn't hear the gospel in a Catholic context at Mount St. Michael Academy. I'm not saying that they didn't preach it. I just didn't hear it there. It was in a Protestant context, La Brie Fellowship, Francis Schaeffer, the late Francis Schaeffer, that I responded to the gospel and came to a personal knowledge of Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. But it wasn't. Until 22 years later that I actually discovered Christ's Church. In fact, that's often the way I put it, that, you know, I came to know Christ personally in 1970, but in 1992 I found his church. And so in 92 I came back to the Catholic Church, and that's been about 8 years now.
I think it's important to recap also a little bit about why you were a committed Protestant.
Right.
How involved you were in teaching and in the philosophy and theology of the Protestant faith.
Right. I mean, I did my undergraduate studies at a college in Chicago, which was, you know, deeply committed to the Calvinist tradition, the Reformed tradition, Protestantism, you know. And so when I finished there in 1973, I went to the Free University of Amsterdam, which was founded by the great neo-Calvinist theologian, politician, statesman, Abraham Kuyper. And from Kuyper's tradition, a whole school of Christian philosophy came forth. And so the professors that I had at Trinity Christian College in Chicago, they were deeply committed to the Calvinist intellectual tradition.
Was Schaeffer part of the Kuyper?
Schaeffer
tradition?
Was a Calvinist in some respects.
In the Kuyper tradition?
I would say in the Kuyperian tradition, yes. In fact, although he was influenced primarily by a man that you may have heard of, Hans Ruckmacher, who taught at the Free University. He was an art historian. He was a student of a Dutch neo-Calvinist philosopher named Herman Dooyeweerd, who was, you know, a member of the Calvinist tradition.
Well, I'm sure that any of our audience who are of the Reformed background or been to seminary and studied
Kuyper,
are familiar
Bavinck,
with these
Birkhauer,
very well-known systematic right. Calvinist theologians.
You know, and they had a great, their vision of Christianity was comprehensive. I mean, they understood that the battle for men's souls involved the whole culture. So they had a sense of, you know, the Christian being involved in culture, dealing with institutions, high Christian education. Huh? It wasn't the narrow, you know, sort of religious individualism. It was really a total vision. Christ was Lord, and so we had to be involved as Christians. Very much, I would say, the church's teaching on the role of the laity. That's one of the things that wasn't a difficult transition between Calvinism and Catholicism, because they both had a real comprehensive vision of the Christian life, you see.
Yeah. Well, let me pose a, if you want to call it, devil's advocate question to you, maybe in a way a non-Christian or non-Catholic might pose to you a challenging question that deals with our relativism today. Some might say, well, listen, Scripture says that God is love.
Right.
Jesus says that the greatest commandment is love.
Right.
Isn't that all that's really necessary? All this other, the rites and the things that really divide us, isn't the most essential thing love, and that we should treat each other not with non-judgmental or tolerant, inclusive attitudes? Isn't that really what's at the core of our
faith? Well, I think it's obviously a very crucial truth in the scriptures, in the New Testament in particular, that God is love. But we'd have to go back and look at what is the New Testament in particular, if we take the first letter of John in the fourth chapter, to try to understand what it means to say that God is love. Because oftentimes, I mean, that's where people go wrong in the first place. Okay, so we read there in the first letter of John in the fourth chapter, we read that indeed God is love, but it says that God's love has been manifested, has been shown to us in the fact that he sent his son to die for us. Huh? So that tells us something about the gift of God's love. Huh? It tells us also something about the need that we needed Christ to die for us. Huh? Christ died for our sins while we were yet sinners, it says. Christ died for our sins. So to understand God's love there, we have to see it related to the righteousness of God, God's justice, if you will, his holiness. And in the middle of his love and righteousness is his mercy. Huh? So you and I are called to love others in the very same way that Christ loved us. Huh? How did he love us? How did he love us? He loved us by taking our sins upon himself. Huh? So now we have the notion of sin. We have the notion of sin. We've been alienated from God because of our sins. Huh? So that tells you that there's something, you have to live your life in such a way that the choices that you make are going to be worthy, are going to conform with the will of God. Huh? So the love of God can't be in contradiction to God's righteousness, God's holiness, God's justice. Huh? In fact, in the very same first letter of John, in the fifth chapter, we find St. John writing that we demonstrate the love of God in our lives by obeying his commandments. Huh? We read in other passages about the choices that people make that in fact are incompatible with the kingdom of God, incompatible with loving God. Huh? So we mustn't play off love against the commandments. We mustn't play love off against God's justice, his righteousness, because then there's no way to make sense of why Christ came to die for us, why he sent his son. So in terms of our attitude towards others, then of course we should love others in the very same way that Christ loved us. Okay? So we should love them. We should be merciful. We shouldn't glory in the iniquity of others. But that doesn't mean that we can't make judgments about their beliefs, or that we can't make judgments about their conduct. I mean, it would make no sense. Why would the New Testament say that, in 1 Corinthians 6, why would it say that certain kinds of choices and actions are immoral, and that they're not only immoral, but that St. Paul says you can trust this saying that those who commit these sins won't be able to enter the kingdom of heaven, won't be able to enter the kingdom of God, you see. So as far as the practical is concerned here, it seems to me we must we must make a distinction between how we relate to people, and there, of course, we must be ethical, we must respect them, they have dignity, they're created in the image of God, so we mustn't do violence to them, oppress them, or force them to believe things. But that's not the... And, of course, we mustn't judge their eternal standing before God, but that's not... That's how we relate to them is a separate matter from how do we relate to their beliefs? How do we relate to the claims they make? How do we judge their actions? Seems to me that the first is an ethical matter. The second is a matter having to do with judgments that the New Testament calls us to make. St. Paul says in 1 Thessalonians, you're supposed to test all things. Embrace the good. Reject what is evil.
Test the
spirits in the first letter of John. We're called to discern good and evil. So it seems to me that you first have to go back and understand what it is that the Scriptures teach about the love of God, that love and righteousness and justice and God's holiness are not contradictory, and that love and the commandments, God gave us the commandments so that we could discern what does it mean to be virtuous. So I think that there's a failure there to understand the biblical meaning of love.
Of love. And in your example, two things I was thinking of. That one, there's an example of the way the enemy, the devil, can take something that's good and twist it, make it out of proportion.
Right.
And it wasn't that what the 20th century was kind of all about. I mean, if love is the center of everything, well, what did the 20th century do with love?
Right. Well, they distorted it, of course.
Yeah.
They distorted it. They put it in opposition to truth. They put it in opposition to right and wrong. I mean, clearly the great example here that people often misunderstand when Jesus says, whoever hasn't sinned, you'd be the first person to throw that stone, okay? Yeah. Well, of course, all of us are sinners, and so we mustn't judge. We must love in the very same way that God loved us, which means that we have to be merciful, we have to be loving. God loved us.
But Jesus, in that parable, still told the woman,
sin no more.
Sin no more.
Exactly.
Yeah,
sin
right.
no more. He didn't say, well, who am I to say what's right and wrong here? Or everybody has their own standards. Or, I've not walked in your shoes. All the cliches that people use, which ultimately implies that they have, a relativist view of morality, that morality is a private matter. Who am I to say what's right and wrong? So it's a confusing, it's a confusing picture. It confuses what, the nature of God.
I was going to say, doesn't it also stem from a kind of a minimalization of what's important so we can get along with one another in society,
sure.
relativism, indifferentism.
Sure.
As long as we love, or as long as we have Jesus, or just don't judge anyone else's
well,
faith.
What is,
or what is the least common denominator that we
sure.
can focus on? Isn't that really a reduction level?
Well, what is it? I mean, what is it that people think judgmentalism is? Judgmental, a person who's judgmental is a person who thinks that somebody else is wrong. That's really what it amounts to. Tolerance means that you should, if you're truly a tolerant person in our culture, that means you don't say that anybody's wrong. But of course, tolerance as a virtue only makes sense because you're exercising forbearance. You are being forbearing towards something that in fact you think is wrong, bad, evil, and you're exercising tolerance there. Tolerance only makes sense in that context. Otherwise it wouldn't be a virtue. So we fundamentally misunderstand the nature of God's love. We misunderstand that we need to distinguish between how we relate to people, which has to be ethical. We ought to love them with the very same love that Christ gave us, showed us. The gift of the Father manifested in the Son and communicated through the Holy Spirit, we ought to love them in that way. But that doesn't mean that we can't make judgments about their actions, about their beliefs, because then it makes no sense. You won't understand the atonement. You won't understand the atonement. You won't understand what it means. Why did Christ have to die for us then? If it has nothing to do with justice.
It really makes a lie to everything else.
Absolutely.
If we make that the only...
Absolutely.
And there's that wonderful phrase in Ephesians 4, speaking the truth in love.
Speaking the truth in love, that's right.
There's the both sides of that.
Well, and there are so many passages from St. Paul where he very clearly says, be loving, be kind, be respectful. And yet at the same time, right in the same breath, he says, correct, rebuke, You know, in First Timothy 3, he says, you know, speak in such a way that, of course, you will be provided with the opportunity so that you can present them to the truth, so that they might respond to the gospel.
Why don't we go with this first email?
Sure.
Because this tags on to some stuff that you've been saying. It's from Steve in Gaithersburg, Maryland. Dear Marcus and Eduardo, a very good friend of mine, currently in the catechumenate, has been struggling with the issue, is Christ a way or is Christ the way to know God? While he acknowledges the ability of other faiths to obtain insight, he does not believe that they can ultimately lead anyone to an intimate and saving knowledge of the Creator. I would appreciate hearing your views on this. Thank you, and God bless. A way or the way?
Well, the way, Jesus himself says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So the church teaches that Jesus Christ is the Savior, the way to the Father, that he is the only way to God. And it teaches that there is no other name under heaven by which men can be saved,
yep,
because Christ himself taught that. Mm-hmm. But I think one of the important things here to get at is by going back and asking yourself, what does it mean to believe? Huh? We talked about this in the last program when I was on, but just to briefly say something here, because that's often where people get tripped up, it seems to me. Huh? To believe, what does it mean to believe? To believe means that you hold something to be true. You hold it to be true. And if you hold something to be true, that means that you then have to ask yourself the question, what makes it true? Well, what makes it true, of course, is not my believing it. Huh? Mm-hmm. It's true because objective reality is the way the belief says it is. Otherwise, it's false. Huh? Mm-hmm. So if the claim that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life is not true, huh,
yeah,
then no matter how much you believe it, however fervently you hold it, huh, if it's not true in an objective sense, then of course you're believing something that is false. Huh? Mm-hmm. And furthermore, not only do we believe in the sense that we hold it to be true, and not only is it true because objective reality is the way the belief says it is, otherwise it's false, but also if it is true that Jesus Christ is the Word made flesh, if he is the way, the truth, and the life, or whatever it is, whatever assertion that we're talking about there, then the denial of that must be false, because you can't affirm and deny the same proposition. Huh? And so that means that if what I believe is true, then those who deny it must believe something that is false, must be wrong in what they believe, of course. I don't, you know, we're not talking here about how do we know,
yeah,
you know, what it is, how do we know that they're wrong, but simply from the very nature of truth, truth is exclusionary. Huh? So you can't get up there and confess that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and at the same time believe that it's possible that you can be saved through Buddha or Mohammed or something. That's an incoherent, there's something incoherent about that. It's something contradictory.
Now the church recognizes that in that statement of Christ.
Right.
It says that there is one way to the Father through Jesus
right.
Christ. It also recognizes that anyone saved as a result of, let's say, the God judging their heart, they've never heard of Christ.
Right.
They've never heard of Christ, so God judges them.
Through no fault of their own, they've been unevangelized. Right. So through no fault of their own, they've been unevangelized.
Yeah, it's not intended to lead us to complacency. Well, just don't tell
no,
them.
No, that's right.
We're
no,
called to go
absolutely.
Forth. But if, in fact, they've never heard.
Right.
Now, I know as Calvinists, we used to argue about this issue. What about those that have never heard?
Well, they're going to be, all men are going to be judged.
Yeah.
We can even include here the notion of inclusiveness. Huh? Romans 3 says very clearly, you know, there is no distinction here. All men have sinned. Huh? All men have sinned. Huh? And Christ died for all men. So you obviously...
And God wishes that all men would be saved.
That's right. In 1 Peter, God wishes that all men would be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth, okay? So if they're saved, they're going to be saved through the grace of Christ, through the finished work of Christ on the cross. Right. Everyone is going to be judged. Not everyone will be judged on whether or not they've heard of Christ, because if through no fault of their own,
They've been unevangelized. They haven't heard of Christ. They're going to be judged in terms of the amount of light and understanding that they've received.
How they've responded to their conscience, the light of Christ within them.
Romans 2, or even Hebrews 11, verse 3, where it talks about, you know, God, that they have to be sincerely searching for God, that God exists, and believe that He is a rewarder of men who seek Him.
Huh? And you know, it's sad, I remember back in seminary, people almost in vehement arguments against this issue, you know, what's happened to those in the darkest parts of the world that have never heard, and some very strong evangelical committed folk assume that they're damned.
Right.
Because they've not heard.
Right.
Of course, that was the impetus behind so many of the mission movements. But then there was the other extreme of those that said, well, you know, if God elected them,
right,
whether they heard it or not, it's not going to make a difference.
Right, but the truth in that, of course, is that ultimately salvation is a work of God.
That's right.
Okay, so, you know, I often say to people that when we talk about the difference between Catholics and Calvinists on this, of course, both traditions agree that salvation is ultimately a work of God. Mm-hmm. So even, you know, that person who is invincibly ignorant, that person who is not responsible for his ignorance, he's unevangelized. Huh? If he is saved, he will be judged. Yeah. But if he is saved, then he's saved because of the finished work of Christ on the cross, which doesn't mean that we shouldn't be, you know, the urgency of evangelizing is still there, because the condition through no fault of their own is not something that we can judge. That's something the Holy Father says explicitly in one of his catechesis on the missionary mandates, that ultimately we can't judge that condition through no fault of their own. That's a condition that only God in the end can judge.
In fact, getting so involved with talking about what about those people way over there, you know, way in that side of the world, what's more significant is what's happening right here.
Well, that's
and
right.
Sadly, those people who maybe have all the data, have heard it all their life, but have become complacent.
Right.
They've never taken the step.
Right.
Become indifferent, or, you know, it's too hard for me to make that move.
Right.
They're the ones that will be judged much
more. Oh, absolutely,
strongly.
Because they're culpable. They know. So they're going to be judged on the basis of what they know, you see. Yeah. And so they're not unevangelized, huh? But I think, you know, just to bring it back to where we started here, I think a lot of this in our own time has to do with the failure to understand that truth matters. And the way that people hold their beliefs. They don't really understand that to believe this means that you hold it to be true.
Are you ready to handle phenomenology?
Phenomenology.
It says, I'll give you this. And you can,
okay.
I mean, I'm not even sure if it's a disease or what it
right.
is. But we'll find out in a second. Joan from Rockledge, Florida. No, it's a form of philosophy.
Right.
Dear Marcus and Dr. Echeverria, could you please explain phenomenology in simple terms, she asks. I hear a lot about it lately. She hears it in lay and Catholic journals. What is phenomenology?
Well, very, very simply, I know that you had John Crosby here one time, and he tried to explain it. But phenomenology is a school of philosophy in the 20th century. It was the founder of phenomenology was Edmund Husserl, who was a German philosopher. He's actually a very pivotal figure in European philosophy. He was the sort of the source of many great German philosophers, Martin Heidegger, Hans Georg Gadamer, you know, Sartre, a lot of great, even Immanuel Levinas, the French Jewish philosopher. But phenomenology, very simply, what it tries to do is it takes human experience as its starting point, and it tries to describe the richness of that experience. Huh? It limits itself to a description of that, of human experience.
Is it akin to existentialism?
Well, existentialism is phenomenological in that it tries to describe human experience. For instance, in his novel, Jean-Paul, the French existentialist Sartre, you know, gives in tremendous descriptions of the experience of what he titles nausea, the experience of absurdity. You experience the background here, of course, is that existentialist thought that the world was absurd, that you and I were simply the chance product of matter in motion. Huh? There was no purpose to life, okay? So given that context, they then go on to describe the experience of absurdity. Okay. So there's a...
And right and wrong is relative to the experience...
Well,
your experience, my experience?
I think they think that there's a structure to experience. Okay, so they're trying to get at what is the essence of certain experiences, huh? So for instance, even in the Holy Father's, the original Unity of Man and Woman, his Wednesday audience talks, he engages in a phenomenological description of solitude, the nature of solitude. He engages in a description of the human body, how we experience our body, as we act in the world.
If someone was interested in phenomenology, which we don't have time to really...
No, right.
Where would they begin? Where would they might read? I mean, is it compared to...
Well, I think John Crosby has written some good stuff on that.
Good Catholic professor.
Good Catholic professor at Franciscan University. His book, The Selfhood of the Human Person, is a very good book.
All right, let's try and see if we get another email in before we take a break. This comes from Mike in Virginia. Dear Marcus and Eduardo, if someone denies the Immaculate Conception of the Blessed Mother, do they deny the other dogmas of the Church?
Well, the Immaculate Conception, oftentimes people confuse the Immaculate Conception from the Virgin Birth. Huh? So if they deny the Immaculate Conception, are they going to deny that Mary is the Mother of God? I suspect they would, because that Mary is the Mother of God. Certainly, they're going to deny one of the items in the Apostles' Creed. You know that Mary conceived by the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
That's the virgin birth. But
right.
But
I think what he's probably also getting at is the idea that, if there's one or two doctrines here that I'm not real comfortable with, can I just set those aside and believe everything else?
Right.
Is that all right?
Right.
But yet, if I deny one, am I also denying the fullness of the Church?
I don't think that there's any necessary connection between that. I mean, you can have questions about Mary's Immaculate Conception if the Immaculate Conception has to do with that Mary herself was conceived without sin, it seems to me you could still accept that she was the Mother of God, and still accept the virgin birth. Huh?
Okay.
I don't see any necessary connection
theologically in that sense, but the sense of being a faithful Catholic.
Right. In terms of being a faithful Catholic, of course, yes. But in terms
one
of the connection...
The connection is the one, that I think, the side of it that you were taking. And I think there's also the side that recognizes that there are... When we accept the authority of the Church guided by the Spirit, even when we have a doctrine that we're not real comfortable with, we trust the Church.
Well, didn't St. Thomas, he rejected Mary's Immaculate Conception.
Well, it hadn't been declared.
Right. But, I mean, he didn't accept it even,
So from that theological connectiveness.
Right. The one is not necessary. Rejecting that does not lead you to necessarily rejecting that Mary is the Mother of God. Huh?
Right.
But, of course, as you say, I mean, in terms of the Church's teaching, in terms of being a faithful Catholic... in terms of the authority of the Church, that of course one has to accept Mary's Immaculate Conception as one of the teachings regarding Marian doctrine.
Another thing that you and I have talked about bringing up just before we take a break was your work as a layperson, coming to the Church, and you work in the local parish. And I know from my work that many converts coming to the Church have a hard time finding their place, and how they can serve in the Church.
Right.
Talk a bit about your own work.
Well. You know, praise God that my wife and I, we belong to a very wonderful parish, St. James Church in St. Joseph. We have a very wonderful holy parish priest, Father Vincent Rogers. In the last 2 years, I've been, deeply involved in the RCIA program, which actually doubles for us as adult ed, because we try to give a systematic presentation of the Catholic teaching, the catechism. I'm also involved in starting up a Bible study. The diocese also requires certain courses that for catechists and Catholic school teachers to be certified. And what's really at the core here, what's really important for me is to give Catholics a sense of the fullness of the Christian life. Huh? Because too often, the Second Vatican Council said that one of the most pernicious errors in the modern age was that Christians, and also, and in particular Catholics, they tend to compartmentalize the life of faith and their life. Huh? Mm-hmm. So they live in this kind of dualistic framework. Huh? Faith is here, life is there. Huh?
Faith is Sunday.
Faith is Sunday, yeah. Exactly. So here we have the calling of the laity, which in fact has remained, people have been confused about that, huh? They, you know, full participation in the church has been taken to mean, you know, being lectors or being ushers or being extraordinary Eucharistic ministers, when in fact the Second Vatican Council taught that the calling of the laity was to be involved in the world, bringing the light of Christ, transforming the world in your station in life, you know, as teachers and doctors and lawyers, education, culturally, involved politically, huh? Yeah. So,
Christian as laity, in fact,
that's right.
The front line.
That's right.
The laity,
exactly.
Are the front line, because they're the ones most in touch.
That's right.
With those outside the church. Why don't we'll come back to this after our break. It's time to take a break. But let's talk maybe a little bit more about the work of the laity, and then we'll take your questions. So come, stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Our guest this evening is Dr. Ed Echeverria. He's been answering a variety of questions, philosophy and such, and we have a lot of emails. But just quickly, maybe one last thought on the role of the laity, and then we'll go to our next email.
Right. The most important thing I think for understanding the call of the laity is to free ourselves from this dualistic mindset, this mindset that compartmentalizes faith and life. Huh? In fact, the Second Vatican Council document, Lumen Gentium, in the fifth chapter on the laity, and in the Decree of the Laity, a whole document devoted to what the nature and responsibility of the laity is. The Holy Father's encyclical, Christi Fideli Laici, makes very clear that the calling of the laity is to be in the world, huh? To bring Christ in the world, huh? To transform the world through the Christian faith, through Christian principles. And if I may, just a passage from the Catechism, which in fact is quoting Lumen Gentium. It says, by reason of their special vocation, it belongs to the laity to seek the kingdom of God by engaging in temporal affairs, so in the affairs of this life, and directing them according to God's will. It pertains to them in a special way so to illuminate and order all temporal things with which they are closely associated, that these may also be effected and grow according to Christ, and may be to the glory of the Creator and Redeemer. So it's not just evangelization, okay? It's not just that we're concerned with the saving of those that are lost, but it's also a concern for the structures of society, for institutions, for culture as a whole.
It's the living out of the love that we were talking about earlier.
Exactly. That's right. And so, and that links up with, in fact, the whole question of Catholic higher education.
Yeah. Okay. Which... that was a good segue into this email. You knew we were going.
That's right.
This email is from A. Acacio, T.O.P., from Brooklyn, New York. Dear Eduardo, I would like you to briefly comment on the role of the Ex Cordia Ecclesia document and how Catholic professors are obliged to teach the truths of the faith with full assent to the magisterium.
Right. Well, in fact, you could really say that Ex Cordia Ecclesia comes out of this conviction that the Catholic lay faithful should be involved bringing Christ in the realm of higher education. Huh? The Holy Father wrote an apostolic constitution on Catholic colleges and university in 1990. And he set out a magnificent, a marvelous vision of what Catholic education is. Huh? And in particular, he set out the principle that we as Catholic educators should be involved in showing the connection between faith and reason, between the life of the mind and the life of faith, responding to the challenges that our culture brings. Huh? And this happens from out of the church, huh? Because ex cordia ecclesia means from out of the heart of the church. Huh? So we're involved there. And ex cordia ecclesia encourages us. In fact, it gives us a mandate as Catholic educators, as Catholic intellectuals, to be involved in bringing Christ in the realm of education.
Yeah, and I mean, the reason that Catholics have always insisted on the faith being taught in their schools is so that lawyers will learn how to be lawyers through a mindset of Christ.
That's right.
Teachers,
that's right.
And engineers,
right.
All through a mindset
of Christ.
That's
right.
In fact, let's take our next caller.
Okay.
Because we want to get a lot in tonight. This is Jerry from Chicago. Hello, Jerry. What's your question for us tonight?
Yes. I was wondering if there was anywhere in Scripture where anyone, any human being ever prayed to someone like Isaiah, Moses, Jeremiah, Daniel. Because I feel we should only pray to God.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you can just tell me one scripture where it's recorded where someone prayed to someone who was dead, like Moses or to Jeremiah or whatever.
Thank you very much, Jerry.
Well, I think it's important first to understand if your question is a question about trying to understand why Catholics pray to the saints, huh? Then we have to understand the nature of that activity, the nature of that prayer. And the best analogy to that, it seems to me, is when, you know, we as Christians ask other people to pray for us. Huh? We ask our friends, we ask our parents, we ask our pastors, we ask other people to pray for us because not because we can't pray to Christ directly, not because we can't pray, to the Blessed Trinity directly or anything like that. We ask them to pray for us just as we would ask any other Christian to pray for us.
Yeah, a lot of this particular doctrine, which also touches on praying to Mary,
right,
and all of that, all gets down to our understanding of the communion of saints.
Right,
and what
the
happens
communion
to people
of saints, absolutely.
After we have died,
right,
what happens to their soul. And
right, and they're alive. We believe as Christians that those who die in Christ, St. Paul says that, you know, you can, this is a trustworthy saying, he says, you know, those who die in Christ will rise, you know, rise to new life. Huh? So we don't believe that we're praying to dead people. That's
Jesus
the first
makes
thing.
That statement that
that's
God
right.
is the God of Abraham,
right.
Isaac, and
Jacob. And
in
they
the
are,
present tense.
That's right. They are alive. They are alive with the Lord, okay? So if they are alive with the Lord, we're not praying to dead people, okay? In the second place, as you rightly pointed out, the communion of saints. In in Hebrews 11, the great cloud of witnesses, the saints, we are surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses, huh? So they're alive. There's this great cloud of witnesses that testify, that are standing before, you know, the throne of God, that are praying.
Illustrated in Revelation.
It is illustrated in Revelations. And so we are asking them, not because we don't have access to the Father, huh? Not because they are greater than Christ, because if they have access, we all have access to the Father only because of what Christ did for us, his finished work on the cross. So we are uniting our prayers with them, but we are, in fact, all of us uniting our prayers with Christ, who is our great high priest, who gives us access to the throne of God because of what he did for us on the cross. And so it's not a question of praying to dead people because they're alive in Christ. It's not a question, there's the communion of saints, and it's a question of asking them to pray for us, huh?
Okay.
And not praying to them because it's not that they have some kind of special power or anything like that. They are united, as we are united, in fellowship with Christ.
All right. Wonderful. Let's go to our next email. This is Mark from Mark. Says, hello, Mark and Eduardo. Where do scruples come from, God or the devil? I suffer from scruples. How do scruples affect truth? Jesus said, all those committed to the truth hear my voice.
Well, scruples.
What are scruples? Yeah,
well, I mean, sometimes
some of our
overly scrupulous.
May not use that term.
Right. So if you're overly scrupulous, that means that you're constantly, self-examining every single thing that you do, huh? And perhaps always wondering whether or not you've done the right thing or whether or not you've sinned. I think people who are overly scrupulous, in effect, really have not allowed the love of God to be perfected in them, huh? Because they're afraid. Huh? To go back to the first letter of John, in the very same chapter, in the first letter of John, chapter 4, it talks about perfect love casting out fear, huh? And letting love have its full way with us, in a Ronald Knox translation of that verse, having love have its full way with us, huh? And then, of course, we know that we are responding to the commandments. We're living out the commandments as a response to the very love of God, huh? We should love others in the very same way that Christ loved us. We should obey the commandments, not because we're afraid that God is going to strike us dead, huh? But because we love God. And of course, we have to trust in God's mercy. People who are overly scrupulous, I think, perhaps misunderstand the love of God. They misunderstand God's mercy.
You can have a sincere
mercy.
Desire
right.
to be close to Christ.
Right,
I mean,
sure.
That's really what drives
sure.
it in many ways. But maybe it's, again, like you said, an inadequacy to forgive themselves, and ask me to receive and believe in God's forgiveness.
Well, maybe they don't really believe that God loves them. You know, and
well, here's another question. Where do the scruples come from God or the devil, was his first question.
Well, you know, authentic, I mean, there is such a thing as authentic self-examination, huh?
Right.
So there's nothing wrong. Obviously, we have to examination of conscience. Obviously, you have to discern, you know, what's right and what's wrong. You have to ask yourself those questions. But it's when you're fixated, and that, it seems to me, can be the work of the devil, because the devil then
prevents
you from mm-hmm. accepting the fullness of God's love for you. It prevents you from accepting the fullness of God's mercy. It prevents you from, in fact, realizing, from allowing God's love to have its way with you, such that you will live your life in response to the love that he has shown you in Christ.
Would you describe it in kin to the idea of someone that, one person that can go wash their hands before dinner, and then they believe that they're clean and they can eat? Or another person washes their hands and never can believe that they're clean. They never
right.
get to eat because
right.
they keep going back and
right.
washing their hands over and over again,
right.
over and over again,
right.
over and over and over and over.
Absolutely. I think that's a good analogy. I think there comes a point where you have to make a heartfelt act of repentance and accept and trust that what Christ did for you on the cross is sufficient. It covers all your sins. It covers all your sins. And then, of course, you know, the problem in our age is not scrupulosity, though, it's laxity. So we, you know, we've gone the other side of it. I mean, most people are not scrupulous. Most people now are lax, huh? Which is where we began. I mean, most people think, you know, God is love, so as long as I'm sincere, you know, it doesn't really matter. You know, they're antinomians. They read the Gospels and St. Paul's letter, and they think that love is somehow incompatible with the commandments, as we said.
Okay. Let's take our next email. David in Texas. Dear Journey Home, I have some questions regarding free will. If God is omniscient, he must know beforehand exactly... Well, we're getting into these Calvinists. He must know beforehand exactly what a person will do in a given situation. In that case, it seems that a person is not free to do the alternative to what God knows he or she will do. Please help.
Well...
And he says cordially, too.
So yeah, this is... This is a difficult question. It's a question that philosophers and theologians have struggled for at least 2,000 years with. So,
but there's an important way to approach that question.
That's right, and that's what I'd like to say something about. The way that Augustine and Aquinas and Boethius and others approached it was by taking God out of time. God is timeless. Huh? He is in the eternal now. So when the New Testament talks about, you know, foreknowledge, huh? It doesn't really mean that God is actually in time, you know, foreknowing something. It doesn't mean that actually that God is in the past knowing something that's in the future. It's that time, you know, is coextensive with God's eternal presence. Yeah. Huh? Here's God. He's eternally present in the successive stages of past, present, and future. Huh? So he doesn't foreknow anything. He knows everything from his eternal present. Huh? And so this is how they tried God was simultaneously present to the successive periods of past, present,
and future. It's hard for us to understand it because we are limited within this time.
Well, that's right. And we use temporal language.
That's right.
We say God foreknew. And so that implies succession, past, present, and future. Yeah. but that's an anthropomorphizing. That is to say, that's a human way of speaking about God. We bring him down to and use temporal terms to speak of him. They said, no, God is simultaneously present, past, present, and future.
And there's an example, if we force things into our categories, we end up with such strong contradictions that it paralyzes in our faith. If God is omniscient in that sense, foreknows, predestines, then why pray?
Right.
If our prayers have no effect whatsoever, then what it does in the end is it impedes and paralyzes us. But we have to recognize the mystery of the both and.
Right. Well, if I may here just say one thing. However one goes on to resolve this question, one has to hold both that God is sovereign in power, knowledge, goodness, etc., but also that human beings are significantly free. It seems to me, however one goes on to reconcile these two truths, they are truths. God, we must not limit God's sovereignty, and at the same time, we must take seriously, utterly serious, that human beings are significantly free, that they make choices that have significance. Otherwise, otherwise we undermine, it seems to me, the gospel, the scriptures, how we'd understand. If human beings aren't free, how we'd understand that God, that our choices have eternal significance, such that we can, in fact, be in hell for those choices.
All right. I'm not sure we closed that.
No, we didn't, obviously. But no, but I mean,
this email is yelling at us, so
let's go.
We'll keep moving.
Let's go.
Lucy in Tennessee, dear Marcus, the church teaches that all revelation ended with the death of the last apostle. Within that teaching, how do we understand the doctrine of our Blessed Mother's Immaculate Conception?
Well, that's right. I mean, there is no more revelation. God has said it all in Christ. The Catechism, in fact, quotes St. John of the Cross there. So there is a public, objective revelation. Nothing can be added to that revelation. So any private revelation here is... Marian doctrine is not in the same category as private revelation. Right. Teresa of Avila or St. John of the Cross or whatever, those are private revelations. So we have to make that distinction firstly. Secondly, it seems to me we have to go on and talk about the development of doctrine.
That's right.
So we have to take, we also have to have a more robust sense of Mary's presence in the scriptures, in both the Old and New Testament, at least in terms of her being prefigured through other women in the Old Testament, the new Eve, and so on. We have to have a more robust sense of her presence in the scriptures before we go on then to talk about doctrinal development.
And maybe rather than use that doctrine as an example, because it gets us into a lot of things, just set the Immaculate Conception aside and just use the word Trinity.
Right.
I mean, the Trinity is an example of a doctrine that was not officially defined.
Well, even the two natures of, Chalcedon. I mean, how do we understand that Christ is both God and man?
That's right.
I mean, it's only subsequent councils of the church that actually properly, conceptually clarified that relationship for us,
They didn't invent at that
No, they did not
meeting
invent, no.
after a bunch of cups of coffee how to understand Jesus.
No,
but what they did is that given the many traditions that had come down and growing conceptual ideas and contradicting ideas, they had to say which of these is the truth delivered to us by Christ and how we understand. So we have the Trinity and the divine natures of Christ and the authority of the seat of Peter and all these things are officially defined later. But not invented, they're confirmed.
Right. Well, and if you have no sense of doctrinal development, you see, this is going to be very difficult you. Because you have a diminished sense of doctrine, you have a diminished sense of development in the church. And so you have to go back, it seems to me. Even more simply, you go back and talk about the place of Mary. I mean, even begin with the mother of, Mary is the mother of God. Yeah. I mean, some Protestants have difficulty with that. But if Jesus is God and Mary is his mother, then Mary is the mother of God. It follows logically, of course. I think you have to begin by getting a more a robust, a more biblical sense of Mary's presence scripturally is present in the Bible. There's that recent book that's that Catholics United for the Faith have put out on Mary, the Mother of God, which is
Catholic for a Reason.
The Catholic for a Reason number two.
Yes, all about Mary.
All about Mary. It's a marvelous book, and it's really written for the ordinary layman. It's and it gives you, I think, a good perspective.
Okay, let's try and squeeze a few more.
Sure.
In here. This is from El Garcia, Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Dear Marcus and Eduardo, many Catholics wholly believe that they are in possession of the faith, but read literature such as Deep Chakra and other New Age materials that encompass many different philosophies. I don't know what Deep Chakra is.
Yeah.
Is it Deep He's Chocolate? No, it's Deep Chakra. does this not contradict with the Catholic doctrine?
Well, look, there are a lot of things that I read to gain a better understanding of the culture that I live in, but I, so that I can more properly address that culture. But I think the email here is obviously suggesting people that find something insufficient in the Catholic faith, and so feel the need to search elsewhere to supplement. Well, that of course is fundamentally a mistaken mindset to have. Huh? If the Church, as we believe as Catholics, as the Church herself teaches, has the necessary means of salvation, if the Church is the fully and rightly ordered expression of the body of Christ, then of course we don't need to search elsewhere to find the truth. Huh? Other things, we can read all kinds of things that might deepen, help us to better understand the Scriptures, help us to better understand the teachings of the Church, and so on. But if we have the mindset that it's somehow the Church is insufficient, Christianity is insufficient, Christ needs to be supplemented by other ways of looking at things, it seems to me there's something fundamentally wrong here. This person has fundamentally misunderstood. This Catholic has fundamentally misunderstood that Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. Huh?
All right. Let's see if we can get one caller in. We've got about 3 minutes to go. Hello, this is Sam from New Jersey. What's your question for us tonight?
Hello.
Hi, Sam.
Yeah, hi, I'm here. I'm calling from New Jersey.
Yeah. What's your question?
I have a question on the efficacy of prayer.
Uh-huh.
Is one person's prayer as good as the next?
All right, thanks, Sam. That's
I'd
good.
Like to think that, my prayers are not as good as Mother Teresa's.
All right, so...
Well, perhaps the best way to think about this, think about the person that in the gospel, that person who only gave as much as they had, the two copper pennies, let's say, I forget exactly how much she gave, but gave as much as she had, whereas the other person, gave very little, but could have in fact given a lot more. Huh? Well, it seems to me Christ, our Lord, is going to accept what you give him from your heart. Huh?
Yeah.
And so your prayers are just as good, it seems to me, as the prayers of Mother Teresa, huh? Because we're both of us are, we're all members of the body of Christ. We belong to the mystical body of Christ. We all stand before, Christ, who through his finished work makes it possible for our prayers to be united with him as the intercessor. Huh? So in that respect,
First of all, that's kind of a judgment. We're not on the plane to decide in one sense whether our prayers are as effective as mothers.
Right. So, but in terms of worth, I mean, in terms of who can pray and who, in terms of who God is going to listen to, that's different, it seems to me, for whose prayers are going to be more effective.
That kind of sounds like those voices within that try to discourage us from prayer. You're not worthy of prayer. God won't hear you.
Well, none of us are worthy. We say that every day at Mass. None of us are worthy. Huh? Christ made us worthy by dying for us on the cross. Huh? So we don't come to the Lord because we're worthy. We come with empty hands. We come because of what he did for us. We come through grace alone.
Yeah, and Christ's great example of the model of prayer is not for what others think of us when we pray, but when we're alone with our Lord and we've opened our heart to him, that's the key of prayer. We may not know anything about what it means to be contemplative.
Right.
Defined that way, but it's opening our heart to Christ. Eduardo, it's wonderful to have you on the program.
Thank you, Marcus. It's been my
good
pleasure.
Questions. I'm not sure we answered everything in completeness, but that's the way it is, a program like this. But thank you.
My pleasure to be here.
And we thank you all for joining us this evening. I want to remind you that if you're interested in getting a copy of Read the Bible and the Catechism in the Year, either write the network or write the Coming Home Network, whose address you'll see later. God bless. We'll see you again next week on The Journey Home.